Hello everyone, welcome to the YouTube channel Jayashree Jawaji. Today we shall continue to read the book Think and Grow Rich by author Napoleon Hill, part 20. The bankers have learned a thing or two during this rapid change which has taken place during the past few years. Impoliteness on the part of a bank official or bank employee today is as rare as it was conspicuous a dozen years ago. In the years past, some bankers carried an atmosphere of austerity which gave every would-be borrower a chill when he even thought of approaching his banker for a loan. The thousands of bank failures during the Depression had the effect of removing the mahogany doors behind which bankers formerly barricaded themselves. They now sit at desks in the open, where they may be seen and approached at will by any depositor or by anyone who wishes to see them, and the whole atmosphere of the bank is one of the courtesy of understanding. It used to be customary for customers to have to stand and wait at the corner grocery until the clerks were through passing the time of day with friends and the proprietor had finished making up his bank deposit before being waited upon. Chain stores managed by courteous men who do everything in the way of service short of shining the customer's shoes have pushed the old-time merchants into the background. Time marches on. Courtesy and service are the watchwords of merchandising today, and applying to the person who is marketing personal services even more directly than to the employer whom he serves, because in the final analysis both the employer and his employee are employed by the public they serve. If they fail to serve well, they pay by the loss of their privilege of serving. We can all remember the time when the gas meter reader pounded on the door hard enough to break the panels. When the door was open, he pushed his way in uninvited with a scowl on his face which plainly said, "What the hell did you keep me waiting for?" All that has undergone a change. The meter man now conducts himself as a gentleman who is delighted to be at your service, sir. Before, the gas companies learned that their scowling meter men were accumulating liabilities never to be cleared away. The polite salesman of oil burners came along and did a land office business. During the Depression, I spent several months in the anthracite coal region of Pennsylvania studying conditions which all but destroyed the coal industry. Among several very significant discoveries was the fact that greed on the part of operators and their employees was the chief cause of the loss of business for the operators and loss of jobs for the miners. Through the pressure of a group of overzealous labor leaders representing the employees and the greed for profits on the part of the operators, the anthracite business suddenly dwindled. The coal operators and their employees drove sharp bargains with one another, adding the cost of the bargaining to the price of the coal, until finally they discovered they had built up a wonderful business for the manufacturers of oil burning outfits and their producers of crude oil. The wages of sin is death. Many have read this in the Bible, but few have discovered its meaning. Now, and for several years, the entire world has been listening by force to a sermon which might well be called, "Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." Nothing as widespread and effective as the Depression could possibly be just a coincidence. Behind the Depression was a cause. Nothing ever happens without a cause. In the main, the cause of the Depression is traceable directly to the worldwide habit of trying to reap without sowing. This should not be mistaken to mean that the Depression represents a crop which the world is being forced to reap without having sown. The trouble is that the world sowed the wrong sort of seed. Any farmer knows he cannot sow the seed of thistles and reap a harvest of grain. Beginning at the outbreak of the World War, the people of the world began to sow the seed of service inadequate in both quality and quantity. Nearly everyone was engaged in the pastime of trying to get without giving. These illustrations are brought to the attention of those who have personal services to market to show that we are where we are and what we are because of your own conduct. If there is a principle of cause and effect which controls business, finance and transportation, the same principle controls individuals and determines their economic status. What is your QQ's rating? The cause of success is in marketing services effectively and permanently have been clearly described. Unless those costs are studied, analyzed, understood and applied, no man can market his services effectively and permanently. Every person must be his own salesman of personal services. The quality and the quantity of service rendered and the spirit in which it is rendered determine to a large extent the price and the duration of employment. To market personal services effectively, one must adopt and follow the QQ's formula, which means that quality plus quantity plus the proper spirit of cooperation equals perfect salesmanship of service. Remember the QQ's formula, but do more apply it as a habit. Let us analyze the formula to make sure we understand exactly what it means. Quality of service shall be constructed to mean the performance of every detail in connection with your position in the most efficient manner possible, with the object of greater efficiency always in mind. Quantity of service shall be understood to mean the habit of rendering all the service of which you are capable at all times, with the purpose of increasing the amount of service rendered as greater skills is developed through practice and experience. Emphasis again placed on the word habit. Spirit of service shall be construed to mean the habit of agreeable, harmonious conduct which will induce cooperation from associates and fellow employees. Adequacy of quality and quantity of service is not sufficient to maintain a permanent market for your services. The conduct or the spirit in which you deliver service is a strong determining factor in connection with both the price you receive and the duration of employment. Andrew Carnegie stressed this point more than others in connection with his description of the factors which lead to success in the marketing of personal services. He emphasized again and again the necessity of harmonious conduct. He stressed the fact that he would not retain any man, no matter how great a quantity or how efficient the quality of his work, unless he worked in a spirit of harmony. Mr. Carnegie insisted upon men being agreeable. To prove that he placed a high value upon the quality, he permitted many men who conformed to his standards to become very wealthy. Those who did not conform had to make room for others. The importance of a pleasing personality has been stressed because it is a factor which enables one to render service in proper spirit. If one has a personality which pleases and renders service in a spirit of harmony, these assets often make up for deficiencies in both the quantity and the quality of service one renders. Nothing, however, can be successfully substituted for pleasing conduct. The capital value of your services. The person whose income is derived entirely from the sales of personal services is no less a merchant than the man who sells commodities, and it might well be added, such a person is subject to exactly the same rules of conduct as a merchant who sells merchandise. This has been emphasized because the majority of people who live by the sale of personal services make the mistake of considering themselves free from the rules of conduct and the responsibilities attached to those who are engaged in marketing commodities. The new way of marketing services has practically forced both employer and employee into partnership alliances through which both take into consideration the rights of the third party, the public they serve. The day of the go-getter has passed. He has been supplanted by the go-giver. High-pressure methods in business finally blew the lid off. There will never be the need to put the lid back on, because in the future, business will be conducted by methods that will require no pressure. The actual capital value of your brains may be determined by the amount of income you can produce. A fair estimate of the capital value of your services may be made by multiplying your annual income by 16 2/3, as it is reasonable to estimate that your annual income represents 6% of your capital value. Money rents for 6% per annum. Money is worth no more than brains. It is often worth much less. Competent brains is effectively marketed, represent a much more desirable form of capital than that which is required to conduct a business dealing in commodities, because brains are a form of capital which cannot be permanently depreciated through depressions, nor can this form of capital be so stolen or spent. Moreover, the money which is essential for the conduct of business is as worthless as a sand dune until it has been mixed with efficient brains. The 30 major causes of failure. How many of these are holding you back? Life's greatest tragedy consists of men and women who earnestly try and fail. The tragedy lies in the overwhelmingly large majority of people who fail as compared to the few who succeed. I have had the privilege of analyzing several thousands men and women, 98% of whom were classed as failures. There is something radically wrong with the civilization and a system of education which permit 98% of the people to go through life as failures. But I did not write this book for the purpose of moralizing on the rights and wrongs of the world. That would require a book 100 times the size of this one. My analysis work proved that there are 30 major reasons for failure and 13 major principles through which people accumulate fortunes. In this chapter, a description of the 30 major causes of failure will be given. As you go over the list, check yourself by it point by point for the purpose of discovering how many of these causes of failure stand between you and success. First, unfavorable hereditary background. There is but little, if anything, which can be done for people who are born with a deficiency in brain power. This philosophy offers but one method, is bridging this weakness through the aid of the mastermind. Observe with profit, however, this is the only one of the 30 causes of failure which may not be easily corrected by any individual. Second, lack of a well-defined purpose in life. There is no hope of success for the person who does not have a central purpose or definite goal at which to aim. 98 out of every 100 of those whom I have analyzed had no such aim. Perhaps this is Vasta. Third, lack of ambition to aim above mediocrity. We offer no hope for the person who is so indifferent as not to want to get ahead in life and who is not willing to pay the price. Fourth, insufficient education. This is a handicap which may be overcome with comparative ease. Experience has proven that the best educated people are often those who are known as self-made or self-educated. It takes more than a college degree to make one a person of education. Any person who is educated in one, who has learned to get whatever he wants in life without violating the rights of others. Education consists not so much of knowledge, but of knowledge effectively and persistently applied. Men are paid not merely for what they know, but more particularly for what they do with that which they know. Fifth, lack of self-discipline. Discipline comes through self-control. This means that one must control all negative qualities before you can control conditions. You must first control yourself. Self-mastery is the hardest job you will ever tackle. If you do not conquer self, you will be conquered by self. You may see at one and the same time both your best friend and your greatest enemy by stepping in front of a mirror. Sixth, ill health. No person may enjoy outstanding the success without good health. Many of the causes of ill health are subject to mastery and control. These in the manner are overeating of foods to conducive to health, wrong habits of thought giving expression to negatives, wrong use of and overindulgence in sex, lack of proper physical exercise, an inadequate supply of fresh air due to improper breathing. 7. Unfavorable environmental influences during childhood. As the twig is bent, so shall the tree grow. Most people who have criminal tendencies acquired them as the result of bad environment and improper associates during childhood. Procrastination. This is one of the most common cause of failure. All man procrastination stands within the shadow of every human being, waiting his opportunities to spoil one's chances of success. Most of us go through life as failures because we are waiting for the time to be right, to start doing something worthwhile. Do not wait. The time will never be just right. Start where you stand and work with whatever tools you may have at your command, and better tools will be found as you go along. Lack of persistence. Most of us are good starters but poor finishers of everything we begin. Moreover, people are prone to give up at the first sign of defeat. There is no substitute for persistence. The person who makes persistence his watchword discovers that old man failure finally becomes tired and makes his departure. Failure cannot cope with persistence. 10. Negative personality. There is no hope of success for the person who repels people through a negative personality. Success comes through the application of power, and power is attained through the cooperative efforts of other people. A negative personality will not induce cooperation. Thank you. We shall continue with next video. Stay tuned. If you like the video, please like, share.